Good afternoon. My name's Uwe Brandes. I'm the executive director of the planning program here at Georgetown. Welcome. This is the fifth lecture in the series, fall series, that we have this this fall. And we're delighted and honored to have Gwen Wright with us here today. Gwen Wright is the director of planning of Montgomery County. And two things I wanted to say about her. One is that in addition to a longer term role at the planning office in Montgomery, she's also had very important experience in Alexandria, and so she really brings kind of a full metropolitan set of experiences to her job now in Montgomery County. And the second thing I wanted to say, and this is really the first of a series of talks that we'll have later in the series that really begins to explore the region, that planning innovation in the greater Washington region certainly is not limited to activities in the central core of the region. In fact, if you look over time, some of the most important innovations and land management, certainly in affordable housing, and even in the preservation of green space, are really in Montgomery County. And I think the Montgomery County office is Office of Planning, I'm sure, is in the kind of upper echelons of the APA legacy of great plans, and so it's really wonderful to have you here today to share with us some of the things that you're working on, some of the dialogues that are relevant and topical in Montgomery County. And without further ado, I'd like to welcome you to the program.
Thank you. Well, thank you for inviting me to be here. I'm excited. I'm excited because this is a new planning program. It sounds like there have been some wonderful speakers before me, and that there will be some wonderful speakers after me in this series. But I wanted to sort of launch in a little bit quickly to my basic topic, which is how Montgomery County is evolving. You've heard about, I guess, in one of the previous lectures, you heard from Harriet Tregoning, and she talked about how the District of Columbia is evolving. Well, I sort of compare it, the District of Columbia is like a fully grown 35-year-old. And in comparison, Montgomery County is like, well, we used to be about, when I worked there in the 90s, we were probably about 16 years old. Now we're maybe graduating from college. We're really finally becoming, I think, a very mature community. The other thing I did want to also mention is, as I go through my talk, one thing you'll probably notice is that I focus a lot on sort of what happens in the real built environment. And that's because I'm actually not a planner by training. I am an architect by training, and I worked for a good part of my career in historic preservation and in architecture and in urban design. So I find myself now the head of a planning agency with 140 planners, and I sort of chuckle to myself because I, again, am not a planner per se. But I do think that the whole idea of planning and what actually then gets implemented and the built environment they're completely intertwined, and you really can't do one without the other. So so I don't know how many of you are familiar with Montgomery County. What we're known for is our Stream Valley Park system, our agricultural preservation program. About a third of the county is in an agricultural reserve with a density of one house per 25 acres and a transfer of development rights program that was one of the earliest ones enacted in the country. Our MPDU program, moderately priced dwelling units, we actually require all new residential projects to provide 12.5% MPDUs. They can provide more than that and get bonus density, but they at a minimum must require 12.5% MPDUs. It makes it one of the more aggressive and more successful affordable housing programs in the country. You've probably seen downtown Silver Spring if you live in the area, which has been a very successful urban revitalization project. Downtown Bethesda, again, you know, really wonderful mixed-use community. The county is also known for its great single-family neighborhoods, its great schools. It's some people consider it sort of the epitome of suburbia in some ways. Where this all started was with the creation in 1927 of a bi-county regional planning agency called the Maryland National Capital Park and Planning Commission. And the goal of that agency was to look at the entire Washington, Maryland Metropolitan District, as it was called, which included not only Montgomery, but all of Prince George's County. And to create a system, again, can't read it very well. I don't know if we can turn the lights down at all, but that dealt with creating a stream valley park system and a highway system. And those were meant to really look at the sort of orderly growth and progression of the district of Columbia over time. And it's sort of amazing how this idea, which was called wedges and corridors, how it ended up actually guiding the growth not only in Montgomery County and Prince George's County, but really of the whole Washington metropolitan region. And the idea was having corridors of growth that would then be interspersed with wedges of green protected low density areas. So we have been following that game plan now in this region for getting on to 90 years. This is how it has played out in Montgomery County. The large green area that you see in the north and western parts of the county is our agricultural reserve. And again, in 1980, we created the Transfer of Development Rights Program. We downzoned about 93,000 acres of land that is one house per 25 acres and doesn't get water or sewer service. So we end up with probably a lot less than one house per 25. We also are lucky enough to have a lot of transportation infrastructure. The little red circles you see represent portions of the red line of the metro. The red line both begins and ends in Montgomery County. We also have a MARC rail system that goes from West Virginia all the way to Union Station with multiple stops through Montgomery County. Interestingly, it doesn't follow the metro line exactly. It does to a point and then veers off through the western part of the county. We also have a strong system of highways, I-270, I-95, Route 29, New Hampshire Avenue, different major vehicular accesses to different parts of the region, which again create our corridors with our green infrastructure, our wedges between those corridors. We're working on some new transit opportunities that I'll be talking about. But as you look at this map, please also note the green Stream Valley parks that run sort of north to south. It doesn't show up as clearly here as perhaps it shows up there in orange here, but it's almost a fan-shaped system of Stream Valley parks that goes through many parts of the county. And those will become important as we talk about how the county is urbanizing and some of the challenges that we're facing. So that's sort of how Montgomery County got to where it is today, but really, you know, who are we today in Montgomery County? Well, our population exceeded 1 million people in 2012, which makes us significantly larger than the District of Columbia and most other jurisdictions in the immediate region. Our rate of growth has declined decade over decade since 1990, which is sort of the sign of a maturing jurisdiction, but it is a very large jurisdiction. As of 2010, our county is majority-minority, with just over 52% Hispanic and non-Hispanic, non-white residents of the county. We're a very well-educated county. A majority have a bachelor's degree, and we're 10th in our share of residents age 25 and over who have a bachelor's degree or higher. And when you look at even post-college degree attainment, it's 30%, and only Arlington of all the nearby jurisdictions has a higher number of people with post-college degrees. The county is also getting older. We have fewer millennials than other jurisdictions nearby. This chart actually shows our share of what I call millennials, people aged 20 to 34. We have 19%, and as you can see in comparison to Fairfax, US, Prince George's, City of Alexandria, DC, and Arlington, we're at the bottom of the pack. In terms of mature professionals who are working ages like 34 to 64, we are almost at the top. Fairfax County is a little higher. And in terms of folks 65 and older, we are at the top. Only the US has a higher percentage. We've been talking about this issue a lot in Montgomery County because we do recognize that attracting a younger generation, attracting millennials, is important from an economic development perspective. They are the next generation of people who will be looking to buy homes, looking to settle in communities. And they also, frankly, are a cross-section of our population that spends a lot of money where they do live and doesn't use all the services that some other population groups do. If they generally don't have the same health needs, the same school needs as some of the other other groups. So it is something that we're concerned about as a county, and we're looking at opportunities to turn that around. As a county, we are embracing transit. These numbers, I think, are surprising to you, certainly to many of the folks who live in Montgomery County, who I've shown these statistics to, but 8% of the households have no auto. When you get within half a mile of a metro, it goes to 14%. 33% of the households own only one auto, and it goes to 44% when you get close to metro. Public transportation is used for 15% of all work trips, and that percentage rises to 28% for people who live within a half mile of a metro station. Those are actually very high numbers for non-single occupancy use, and again, are surprising to, especially to many of the residents who see Montgomery County as totally auto-oriented, but we have been changing. We're working closer to home, and we have smaller households. 63% of the jobs in the county which could be filled by residents of any jurisdiction are filled by county residents. And county residents who can work anywhere in the region are predominantly employed in Montgomery County. What we've seen in the last few years is that job growth has been fueled by the self-employed, while wage and salary employment declined. What all of those numbers mean, at least to me, is that the way we're working is changing. The traditional, you know, Mad Men type of stereotype of the 9-to-5 job where you drive from the suburbs into the city, get there at 9, leave at 5, drive back home, that pattern is changing. People are choosing to work closer to home. There are employment opportunities. And if it isn't a traditional job that they're going to, they're either self-employed, they're entrepreneurs, they're working for much smaller companies rather than the traditional, you know, big corporate kind of situation. One-person households are 25% of all the households in the county, and within half a mile of Metro, it's 43%. And again, I think we know we're low on the millennials, so I think what we're probably looking at are some older people who are choosing to live closer to Metro. And again, anecdotally, we're hearing a lot about some of the folks in the county who've lived in traditional suburban houses choosing to sell those houses and move into places like Silver Spring and Bethesda because it's just easier. So what this comes down to, and again, you know, what I've been thinking about and what we all have been wrestling with in Montgomery County is that the wedges and corridors, the far-flung suburbs, which evolved out of the wedges and corridors effort, need to evolve to centers and boulevards. And that isn't to say that we're abandoning the idea of wedges and corridors, of developing along your transportation corridors. I think what we're really saying is now it's time, we've done that, we've been successful. Now it's time to drill down and start planning in much more detail for those centers that are along the corridors that we've created and to create boulevards rather than corridors to connect those centers. We've had some successes, certainly. There's been a lot of progress up to this point. This is a recently completed project near the Wheaton Metro Station. Many of you may have seen or heard about a lot of the projects underway in the White Flint area, that area which, again, the lower left-hand slide really shows was a sea of typical suburban strip shopping centers with large seas of parking. Well, within those parking lots, we're building buildings, mixed-use buildings, both residential, commercial, with retail on the ground floor. And that's moving very quickly and I think is, again, changing the area and will change the area for forever. We're approving other projects. At our last planning board meeting, we approved a 3.8 million square foot project directly adjacent to the Silver Spring Metro Station at East West Highway called The Blairs. And again, The Blairs was an area that had built up during our suburban history with a series of low-rise and high-rise apartments. What this project does is ties a few of those buildings, which will remain together, with a lot more mixed-use development, with a strong open space component, with underground or structured parking that is going to be contained by active uses. And it's taking what today are a few high rises in the middle of a large, again, sea of parking, and it's going to turn it into an urban neighborhood with lots of opportunities for, again, retail use, social interaction in the open spaces that will be created. It will become a community, not just a series of, again, towers and parking lots. So we have a number of challenges ahead. And again, just like any person who's about to graduate from college or sort of looking to the future to find out what it's going to be like when you're a mature person in the workforce and what you have to do to get ready for that, well, we have quite a few things to do. We have to really develop finer grain plans that create a hierarchy of unique livable centers. We have a lot of different kinds of centers. When I started work in Montgomery County, I emphasized that we're not doing a one-size-fits-all type of planning effort in the county. We do believe in transit-oriented development, but every community needs to be unique. Maybe this comes from my historic preservation background, but I actually believe that you don't always have to tear everything down, wipe the slate clean, and start new with all shiny new high-rise buildings in order to really achieve high levels of density and to actually create the neighborhoods that people want to live in. I mean, one of the things that shocks people, I worked in Alexandria for 5 years as the chief of the development division there. The density of people per square mile in Alexandria is about 5,500 people per square mile. The density in Bethesda, which is one of the densest parts of Montgomery County, is 4,300 people per square mile. The density in the District of Columbia, with the height limits that we have, hopefully for a while longer, is over 10,000 people per square mile. So again, my point is that you can do density. You can get a great deal of housing. You can get great neighborhoods without necessarily having the cookie cutter approach that everything has to be a high rise. There's lots of ways to do density. But when you put more density in an area and you do transit-oriented design, you've got to have the T in TOD. And that means a lot frequently of public investment in new transit. And we're working on that, and I'll talk about that briefly about what we're doing in Montgomery County on that. We have to address conflicts between good urban goals, like creating grids that are going to that will help us handle traffic and handle new density, and the environmental protection provisions that are very, very important in Montgomery County. There are some really inherent conflicts. We need to provide high-quality open spaces, including urban parks and public spaces that we really haven't. We've had stream valley parks. We haven't had great urban parks, and we're working on that. And we have to establish placemaking features and recognize the unique characteristics of different parts of Montgomery County. So one of the things that we're doing on that first idea of sort of finer-grained plans and is that we're looking at really introducing another kind of plan into our hierarchy of plans in Montgomery County. We've had, again, as this large bi-county regional planning agency, we've tended to look at things, you know, from, you know, the 30,000-foot level. We have a great general plan. We do these big functional plans that cover the whole county. We do area plans that might be 3,000 acres of land all being studied and rezoned at one time. We've done a few sector plans, mainly for our central business districts. But what we're going to really focus on is doing what I call small area plans. Instead of 3,000 acres in a planning area, we'll be looking at 300 acres. and really drill down in a finer grain sort of way to see how those communities can fit into the larger infrastructure, the larger plan, but still really work as communities. We've also been rewriting our zoning ordinance, like many other jurisdictions in the area, and we have historically had some mixed-use zoning in the county, central business district zones and a few others near transit stations, but we've created a new group of CR, commercial residential zones that will allow for a much greater and more vigorous mixture of uses. But I'm showing these two slides really just to show you that of the mixed-use zones and the commercial zones, which is really what we're focusing on in our zoning ordinance, it's still under 5% of the entire county that will really be addressed or handled in some way through this new zoning rewrite. The single-family residential neighborhoods aren't being rezoned. I mean, heaven help us if we tried. But again, I think that it shows that they're really very small portions of the county that are commercial or mixed use, but they're very important portions, and they actually set the character for many parts of the county. But they certainly are not much more than 5%. What we're finding, and you know, again, this is no surprise, most of you said transit is the answer. Well, it's like, you know, duh, of course transit is the answer. But creating transit opportunities is not as easy as it seems. We've been working hard on two major transit efforts in the county. One is the Purple Line, which will be a light rail system that will run from Bethesda to Silver Spring and then on to New Carrollton. Even though it's running primarily in old railroad right-of-ways, there are portions of it that are going to be above ground, light rail, right through a neighborhood, right through portions of Silver Spring and Long Branch, for example. And figuring out how to introduce that kind of use on a street that's traditionally been either a residential or just a small neighborhood shopping street is a challenge. The other thing we're looking at, and we're actually working with our county council right now on, is a countywide transit corridors functional master plan. And again, we, you know, in Montgomery County, our motto is, you know, make no small plans. And we, rather than just looking at putting in one or two BRT lines, are looking at a countywide system that could ultimately give us up to 12 or 14 BRT lines. For those of you who don't know, BRT is bus rapid transit. And it's an alternative to doing more metro rail or light rail. They are special high-frequency buses that sometimes run in their own dedicated lanes in running ways, but can also run in mixed traffic. In areas like Montgomery County, where introducing new right-of-way gets very challenging for new metro rail or light rail, the idea of bus rapid transit has really taken hold. We're also constantly talking about our roads. And I sort of put these images up because Maryland 355 is a wonderful sort of example, case in point. In the northernmost part of Montgomery County, Maryland 355 is known as Frederick Road, and it's a two-lane road that runs through a rural historic village called Hyattstown. In the middle of the county, it looks like what you see in the upper picture. It runs through Gaithersburg and Rockville, and it becomes Rockville Pike. Actually, in Gaithersburg, it's known for a while as Hungerford Drive, and then it becomes Rockville Pike. And it becomes very wide and very highway-like. It then transitions down to going straight through downtown Bethesda, where it becomes Wisconsin Avenue. And downtown Bethesda has done a great job in many ways of achieving the ideal, which is shown in the drawing on the left of trying to create a boulevard out of a major street, but it's still a very busy street. It still doesn't have a lot of the pedestrian character that some of the streets just off of Wisconsin Avenue, Woodmont and Norfolk and some of the other streets that are west of Wisconsin Avenue in Bethesda, where you have the Bethesda Row project and you have much smaller scale, more pedestrian types of developments. And, you know, again, it's not bad along Wisconsin Avenue, but it certainly isn't as friendly and isn't as pedestrian as the areas off the main drag, Woodmont and some of Arlington and some of the other streets to the west. When you get down to Friendship Heights, and Friendship Heights, a good portion of it is in Montgomery County, again, it becomes truly Wisconsin Avenue. It becomes a much more pedestrian street. Again, I'm assuming you all know about the different neighborhoods in the district. Friendship Heights is where Mazza Gallery, Chevy Chase Pavilion, the Bloomingdale's, important places like that are located. And it is a very pedestrian, very low scale. And the cars are there, but they're moving a lot more slowly than they are even in Bethesda, and certainly more slowly than they are on Rockville Pike farther to the north. And we are constantly wrestling with this issue of how can you take the way 355 is in Rockville and try to make it more like the way Wisconsin Avenue, the very same road, is in Friendship Heights. And it is a very hard thing to do because no one, and I don't mean just our traffic engineers, I mean our citizens, no one wants to give up capacity. No one wants to say, let's narrow the lanes or even reduce a lane or convert a lane to being for bus rapid transit only. It becomes a very, very hard debate to sort of tame these roads once they become the wide highways that they frequently have evolved into. One of my goals is to really say, let's then not allow roads to evolve in that direction. We'll work on the ones that have already become problems, but let's not keep making the same problems happen. And it's a challenge because, again, the traffic engineers are very, very committed to the idea that you have to move people from one place to another. Oh. They are very committed to the idea that people have to, a little musical interlude, that's okay. They're very committed to the idea that people have to move from one place to another, and their way of doing it is make the road wider, make it bigger, figure out a way to get more cars. And I only go back to my last slide, which is no, transit is the answer. More, bigger, wider roads are not the answer. But then when we talk about taming the roads that have become large and wide, you know, we look at ideas and ways of increasing tree planting, increasing the width of sidewalks, sort of trying to make lemonade out of lemons. But those roads are hard. They really end up splitting communities. They work against the goal of community building. They're one of our biggest problems. And the other part of this that I want to sort of share with you is the issue of roads and the environment. I was very lucky in the 5 years I worked in Alexandria, there was a strong existing grid system and a strong commitment to just extend that grid system. Whenever there's a new development, the first thing we did was lay out a framework system of streets, which was in a grid, laid out where public open spaces would be within that grid. And it was really our mantra, you know, grid, grid, grid. When I came back to Montgomery County and started asking questions about some of our upcoming plans and said, well, you know, why didn't you think about a grid? Where's the grid? Well, what I want to go back to is those green fingers, those radial stream valley parks that were part of that early, early 1927 plan. Well, in the 20s, even though you might have a park, there was no problem in putting a road across the park, or in fact, even right along the stream bed. Rock Creek Parkway is a great example. The traffic engineers in the 20s and 30s thought the right way to design a road was actually to build it and put it literally right along the stream. That is today, from our environmental perspective, an absolute no-no. You have to not only stay away from the stream, you have to stay away from the stream buffers. And taking out the number of trees and getting into the steep slopes that frequently are where along stream beds is absolutely forbidden. So even in this project, which is in the White Oak area, we're doing a new White Oak plan. I think you can see this cursor. I suggested, well, you know, you have a road that dead ends here, and you have another road that's here. Why can't we just connect those? And then at least you'd be taking a little bit of traffic off of Columbia Pike, Route 29. And I was told, you know, if you propose that, the environmental community will tar and feather you and ride you out of the county on a rail, because this is the Paint Branch watershed, and it cannot be crossed. You cannot build a bridge across that stream. It's environmentally forbidden. And so I started looking at, you know, other opportunities, oops, of where we could do a parallel road to Route 29 or a parallel road to New Hampshire Avenue, which is here, to begin to try to create the grid system. And there are obstacles almost everywhere you go. Those are going to be challenges we're going to have to overcome, because even if you commit to, again, transit is the answer, even if you commit to transit, there will be people driving. And the roads, if we don't want to widen them, only have so much capacity. And if you've created a situation where there are no alternatives and no, it just is in the District of Columbia, if you know if the traffic's terrible on Connecticut Avenue, you can get onto Wisconsin Avenue. If the traffic is terrible on 7th Street, you get onto 9th Street. There are no options like that. And in fact, in the county where we've had those options, a lot of times they are single family neighborhoods, and those neighborhoods have done everything they can to close off those options by either having the roads declared one way, having them in some cases blocked off entirely. If cars are allowed down them, there are speed bumps and all sorts of traffic calming measures, so that we have, again, put ourselves in a difficult position. We've sort of done everything possible to, in Montgomery County, to either eliminate the grids that we've had or make new grids very, very difficult and impossible to build. So that's one of my challenges for the next year or two, is figuring out how to change that. One of the things I think we have done well in the county and we need to do more of are urban open spaces. We have some wonderful examples. Downtown Silver Spring is the upper left-hand corner. The other spaces are all in Bethesda. They involve public art pieces. Some are hardscape, some are greenscape. One of the things we tend to do, and again, I'm trying to encourage maybe a slightly different viewpoint on this, is we've tended in some of our significant areas to put our big gesture of urban open space right at our 100% corner. For example, in Bethesda, where Wisconsin Avenue intersects with Old Georgetown Road, you have the metro and you have the big metro plaza right at that corner. That plaza has been a problem since day one. No one wants to use it as open space. They've tried programming it, they've tried swing dances and farmers markets and everything, you know, public art, everything you can imagine. But the reality is that wants to be a building. That piece of land just wants to be a building. And frequently, at your 100% corner, that's what the land wants to be. It wants to be buildings. They want to frame your significant crossroads. Plenty of opportunities for open space, but we, again, in the planning work we've done, we've made a few strategic errors in terms of where our open space has ended up being. But we're getting better, and we're recognizing that. Finally, one of the things, again, that we've focused on and will continue focusing on is establishing sort of landmarks and icons. And it goes back to this idea that I mentioned earlier about how communities are not just cookie cutter designs, that they have to grow somewhat organically out of the community that has grown over the course of history. Again, back to my historic preservation background, that places and landmarks that are important to people need to be integrated into new plans, because that's what gives you the sense of a real place. That gives you the sense of something that has real history. We've done that in some cases in Montgomery County. Some examples are the Strathmore Hall, which has both the historic Corby Mansion and the new Concert Hall, which are visible from Rockville Pike. The Bethesda Naval Medical Building, which again is a real landmark. The story behind that, those of you who may have heard this or not heard it, is that there's actually a sketch that Franklin Delano Roosevelt did for this building as they decided to move the Bethesda Naval Command. As they moved the Naval Command to Bethesda, was in the time of Roosevelt's administration, and on the back of an envelope, he sort of sketched a little drawing of what he thought the building should look like, and darn it, it ended up looking a lot like that sketch. You can create new landmarks in a community. It doesn't all have to be historic landmarks, like the Bethesda Crescent Building, which has that great public art at the top. If you've seen it, it's a neon sort of swoosh that that is an emblem. When I'm driving down Wisconsin Avenue towards the district at night, you know you're in Bethesda, probably half a mile away, when you see that neon swoosh at the top of the building that's in the bottom center. And there are other kinds of public art, the Madonna of the Trails statue in Bethesda, the DC marker in Friendship Heights. All of those have been kept and integrated into new developments in Montgomery County. So I'm going to just close with a quote and then take your questions. But this is one that actually came from our original 19, it was used, I should say, in our original 1960 general plan for the Washington, Maryland Metropolitan District. And I think it's a wonderful quote. It's one that I still think about a lot, which is, men come together in cities in order to live. They remain together in order to live the good life. And I think our jobs as planners, as urban designers, is to figure out how to make sure the built environment is conducive to that idea of living the good life. So thank you, and I would be glad to answer your questions.
First, thank you for coming out. My name is Malik Jordan. I'm in the urban and regional planning class. One of our first guests, Dr. Fuller, talked at length about the growth of Montgomery County, mm-hmm. both in terms of the workforce that's making a higher level salaries, but also as far as the sort of supportive workforce. When you're talking about sales force, when you're talking about janitors, when you're talking about maintenance. You alluded to it in your presentation about the moderately priced development units. Mm-hmm. So two questions. One, what is the definition of moderately priced as a average income? And two, do you believe that based on the statistics of how it's gonna grow, that the percentage, the 12%, is going to be able to keep up with that growth? Thank you.
Thanks, that's a great question. And we were actually talking about this a little bit before the lecture started. I think affordable housing is one of the biggest challenges that Montgomery County, and in fact, the whole region has. To answer your question directly about what is counted as a moderately priced dwelling unit, it's 60% area median income. The area median income in Montgomery County is about $95,000, so 60% is somewhere between $55,000 and $60,000 per year, but that is not for one person, that is for a family, yes, family of four. And so it's not, I think, what most people would consider workforce housing. Workforce housing is generally defined as about 80% of the area median income. Our moderately priced dwelling unit program is a very, very good program, but it is not going to fulfill the needs that we have for affordable housing. And in fact, one of the things that I would like to do is, and that we probably will be asking our council to give us the okay to do, is to really look at a functional plan for housing. We've had several master plans recently in Long Branch and Glenmont that are areas where we have either in Glenmont an existing Metro Rail station, and in Long Branch we're going to have a Purple Line station coming in. And, you know, being the good TOD doobies that we are, everyone was saying, well, we need to put density here. We have transit. We have to put density here. And one of the problems is that that density would probably end up displacing large numbers of garden apartments, which are market rate affordable housing. They aren't designated MPDUs. They actually just function as market rate affordable housing. Our council, I think, did a very smart thing. They said in both of these plans, we're going to rezone and upzone the commercial areas, sort of at the core, and let those areas redevelop as mixed use. There's no housing on them now. Under our new mixed use zones, there will be housing, and that housing will have MPDUs, so you'll be adding to the overall number of moderately priced dwelling units in the area. But we aren't going to rezone the garden apartments until we have a better solution. In my previous job in Alexandria, we wrestled with this same issue in the Beauregard neighborhood. There we weren't so lucky because we already had a developer who had bought a large number of garden apartments and said, you know, I'm tearing them down. I have a by right zoning allowance to build townhouses here, and that's what I'm doing. And we stepped in and said, wait, you can't do that. And I mean, you can, it is your right under the zoning to do that, but we really want to look at it and give you some more density if you'll look at it and work with us. And we ended up getting them to agree to set aside 800 units of affordable housing, which is less than the number they are removing. They're removing about 1,200 units. But if we had gone through just our normal formula, we would have gotten nowhere near 800. But it still is a net loss of affordable units. So we have to come up with some better tools. What we have is in Montgomery County is sort of state of the art, but the state of the art needs to get better.
This is a question regarding the wedges and corridors plan. Is there a particular region that you're basing that plan off of?
Yes, the wedges and corridors plan was actually, again, for this area that was called the Washington, Maryland Metropolitan District, and it was all of Prince George's and Montgomery counties, and it created, again, growth corridors in both of those counties, sort of, you know, Washington, D.C. as the hub, and these as the spokes coming out of that hub with the green wedges in between. Other places have adopted the same planning strategy. This was just one of the earliest, if not the earliest, construct of that particular strategy.
Okay, great. And also another quick question. You were talking about some public places kind of done wrong, you know, a place that just wants to be nothing but a building. What are some things in particular that you've learned from that, and is there a kind of process that goes about when you're determining that?
Well, you know, public spaces are really, really interesting. In Silver Spring, there was a period when the whole downtown Silver Spring project was under construction. And while it was under construction, the developer put down green astroturf over essentially a parking lot. And people loved it. I think it was sort of a
pump, 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 p
Pop, 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 pop,
Pump, 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 pump